Thank you very much, sir, for that extremely interesting and engaging session. And after that keynote, I'm sure that we all are feeling very warmed up for the next session that's coming up. The last keynote gave us extensive insights into the global trends. And also, as Dr. Das mentioned, decoding intent is key. Let us get on with the next session, going straight into the boxing ring. Asking the right and pertinent questions, we move into the first panel discussion on decoding captive environments. And for this session, we have three panelists representing three captive environments, that is malls, cinemas, and airports. Our first panelist today is Mr. Rajendra Kalkar, Senior Center Director, the Phoenix Mills. Mr. Kalkar is responsible for operations, leasing, retail MICE, legal, customer relationship, marketing, including top line and bottom line for High Street Phoenix and Phoenix Market City. Sir, please could you join us on stage? Let me introduce our second panelist. Our second panelist is Mr. G. Sharat Chandra, who is Chief Revenue Officer, Times OOH. Mr. Chandra heads the airport, traditional and alternate media revenue function for Times OOH. Can we please welcome Mr. Chandra on stage? And last but definitely not the least, the third panelist. Well, our third panelist for this session is Mr. Clyde Daniels, who is a General Manager, Sales Inbox, INOX. Mr. Daniels is in charge for the sales function at INOX Multiplexes. May I please invite him up on stage? And moderating this session is Mr. Mandeep Malhotra, who is President of DDP Mudra Max. With a Master's in Business Advertising from Melbourne, Mandy has over 12 years of rich experience in the outdoor media space. He has been the recipient of innumerable awards and also is the brain behind recent successful launches of Volkswagen, Aircel, Pepsi, Reebok, Macromax, and many others. Also, you must know that he always likes to match his turban to the color of his pants. May I please welcome on stage Mr. Mandeep Malhotra to moderate this session. Over to you, Mr. Mandeep. Thank you.
So the intro was really intriguing. I think the matching of turban with pants is a recent phenomenon where I'm trying to cover my age with looks. I don't know if it's working or not, but thanks for a lovely introduction, ma'am. Guys, after an inspiring session from Dr. Das and a very important macro view of disengaging to engage, I'm set out for a job to give you decoding of captive audience right from ground. All my three panelists have been kind enough to spare a lot of time for us today. And they come with hands-on experience on asking the, what I call the dirty questions. We'll be asking a lot of those today. But before I start, I would want all of you to know who's sitting on your next side, whether it is right or left, doesn't matter. I think it's important first to disengage from the daily morning chaos that we've all gotten into with traffic being a pain of mind. Just shake your hands with the person next to you, please, and know their names and just engage with them. I think that's a good way to disengage to then you'll engage in this conversation. Okay, so it's Thursday already and we're almost there to end the week. One more day to go. Cheer up. That's a celebration reason enough. But I'm getting towards more serious discussion now. In an era where consumers are posed with plethora of choices and marketers really wooing them, you know, at every possible touch point, both in the real as well as in the digital world, it's fundamental to ensure that brands break away from the conventions and adopt innovative engagement methods to ensure sustained visibility as well as a top-of-mind recall. Experiential engagement as a medium gives an opportunity for the consumer to touch and feel the offering, the product, the service. However, the challenge for us is to be able to fully utilize potential of the available space in order to ensure experience is compelling enough. I would want to start this panel discussion with seeking opinion from all the three panelists about, you know, what are the key factors to consider while designing a campaign to engage with crowds in captive settings, whether it is a mall, multiplex, or airports. Over to you, sir.
Hello. See, whenever we are designing a brand for the captive audience, whenever we're talking to clients out here, we keep one thing in mind out here is that we should actually get a brand to advertise at all of our touch points, the journey of a patron when they're walking into a multiplex. I come from the multiplex. So whenever they walk into a multiplex, we design campaigns right where they can touch at the box office. We either talk about whether they can do, flyer distributions or ticket jackets. Then the walkthrough comes into the main place where there's a check-in counter. We ask them to advertise at the check-in counters. We ask them to advertise at our main foyer, which is, again, we have huge hoardings, backlit boxes where the brand can be recalled. Then we come back into the black box, which is where the screening area is, and there's a huge screen that we have where one can again see the brand on the screen and at the exits. So whenever we're talking to brands, we talk about all the entire journey of our patrons, where they actually can touch all of these points. So at the end, there's a huge recall that comes up from this.
Check. One of the interesting points of preparing for a panel like this is that if you start off with an illustrious keynote address as that of Dr. Das, all the points that I had prepared earlier are now literally insignificant. So I have to now quickly look, think on my feet and figure out what I can share, which has not already been covered with far greater precision and eloquence than Dr. Das. But there's one point I just want to sensitize us to and to take us from where Dr. Das and now you also touched upon. Is that the airport, by and large, the audience that comes there is, they come there because they have no choice. It's a business traveler who has to travel, and by and large, unless it is a very lucrative deal that they're going for, most often people have to travel with a different frame of mind. And it's a business frame of mind, and in a harsh economic environment as it is now, the challenge to engage is far more, let us say, difficult than in an environment where somebody decides to go out of choice. So whether it is dining or entertainment, our audiences or our key decision makers or influencers exercise the choice to spend 2 or 3 hours of their very valuable disposable time. And I think as asset owners or asset concessionaires or asset marketers, we have to be sensitive to the frame of mind in which the audience is entering the particular arena. If the airport is one arena, the cinema entertainment zone, so to speak, is another arena, or indeed retail therapy is another arena. So I think our biggest challenge, as speaking wearing the airport hat, is how are we able to share this frame of mind with potential marketers and their messaging and their intended activity over there?
In Dr. Bhaskar's term, I'm a pre-1990 era person. As a kid, you know, I still remember where I used to spend my time. It was a forceful temple visit. It was a forceful, some community center, some club where we used to go as kids. Perhaps that was the only time or location where we had entertainment. Today you have a Facebook event where you can entertain yourself. You have a multiplex, and you have the modern temples, what we call them as malls. You know, they are a genuine combination of entertainment, socializing, community, trends, fashion, dining, whatever you want. Can actually a marketer ignore such a jewel is the question. When you said that, you know, captive audience, should that be included or not? Then, you know, here are the reasons. What I'm saying is, let's take one location anywhere. Don't go abroad. Let's stay in India. Let's look at a few malls in India. 2 million footfalls a month. Now, you know, that 2 million is a huge number. To engage 2 million is a big challenge. It's a genuine challenge. And brands really will have to work hard to make sure that when they are there, they get the eyeballs for their brand. Because that's not going to be easy. Let's find a way out together today, maybe, to how to utilize, how to make sure that you are able to get your brand message across to those 2 million customers for a mall. Thank you.
So I lovely opening remarks. I would want, if possible, a raise of hands of people who think there is something called captive audience. You know, we've heard since the morning start session with Das and opening remarks from all the three panelists that there is a lot of clutter, you know. So is there a captive audience anywhere around us? If you think yes, please raise your hands. I would just want to do a quick dipstick here. How many of us think there is something called captive audience that exists? 4, 5, 10, 13, 15. So if we look at the sample size, not too many of us think that there is something called captive audience. Sharat, I would want to ask you this question. In your expert opinion, you know, you obviously, as an airport custodian, sell a lot of such opportunities for brands to engage. The audience today here feels that there is nothing called captive audience. You know, is that true in your opinion?
Yes, there is no such thing as a captive audience. There is, however, something called a captivated audience. And our 40 million passengers who come in and out of the Mumbai airport, or the 36 million in Delhi airport, all of them are not captive audiences, but they are captivated. And they are captivated by the device in their hands. They have no time for anything else apart from that device in their hands. To consider them as a captive audience would be a folly on the part of any asset owner. In this particular case, we market the Mumbai and Delhi airports. To consider them as mere captive audiences reeks of us looking at them as lambs to the slaughterhouse. In fact, they were so 15 years ago, perhaps, when they had nothing else to do, having checked in 2 hours early. Today, when people check in, whatever, 40, 50 minutes early, they are more than happy, as to borrow a phrase from Dr. Das, to be left to their own devices. And I think the more, as asset owners, and we look at this as a audience who is captivated by something else, we need to be able to win their engagement, consequently their trust, and consequently the most important of all, their attention span, into that 15, 30, 40 minutes of dwell time that is there in perhaps the entire security hall area, or indeed, to borrow your phrase, Clive, that entire passenger flow experience that is there.
So this is very interesting. The gentleman here is suggesting his sales team should either start selling mobile advertising as an opportunity or look for an alternate career. Is that right, sir?
If I were to look at it as site selling, then it's already, my CV should be floating out on, you know, on all the web job sites. The day I am able to inspire that amount of insights into the partners in this entire exercise. By partners, I mean brand custodians, such as the agencies who have won the trust and confidence of the clients, who clients have parted with the most important element, their very, very limited or indeed hard-won investment into brand marketing, if I am not able to convince my brand partner, such as the media planner or the account planner or the creative planner, creative person, to look at this captive audience into a way of engaging them for that particular activity in that particular environment, yes, then I think we should do whatever it takes. If it means selling them a mobile app to talk to them, or if it means indeed actually selling them a coffee over there, as Dr. Das was saying, talk to them over a coffee. So if I can actually invite people over a coffee, then and that experience, that is the way we would be doing. And probably in less than 3 years' time, that's the way we would be marketing our airport time.
Sure. So guys, this leaves us with a very important question. An industry size of 2,500 crore, where Mr. Chandra is suggesting that we are just growing by fluke, if I may say so, or interpret so. But somewhere all of us, because our livelihood and bread and butter comes from this business, we need to stop, take a pause and think about, you know, how to really grow this business if the captivity or if the experiential space is totally diluting. Is there a model of ROI that we can look at it? Because if you ask me, it's becoming a fairly expensive proposition compared to a radio or any other medium to talk to certain audiences. And it's a very important medium. I think the most important difference I see is that the ability to touch and feel the proposition, the service, the product is something which the experiential marketing offers for sure. Let me ask a question from Clyde here. You know, what is the pricing strategy you sort of garner from brands when they're walking in? Do you have a set rate card for certain touch points that you mentioned, or it's one size fit all, or you customize the requirement, or you see how big the brand is, so charge extra moolah, right?
No, in our case, we have a rate card that goes with everything.
And you stick to the rate card?
Yeah, actually we do stick to the rate card, but yeah, we do a couple of discounts depending on the tenor the client is looking for. If it's a very short tenor, usually there are no discounts, we stick to the rate card. But in our business, whatever we do, whether it's an on-screen advertising, off-screen advertising, the entire inventory, it has a rate card to go with.
So you're suggesting standardization on pricing strategy makes a lot of sense for
yes,
captive audience,
it
right?
Does.
But I have a counter question here, sir. You know, on all the live events that happen, now, these are formations of community out of passion, right? And they are part of what I would call it as destination points for captive audience. And whether it is an airport or event happening in Goa, it may be a sunburn or a bike week. Dr. Bhaskar said getting a tattoo on yourself is brand loyalty and is cultivating brotherhood with a brand in common. You know, where there is a top-up required for quality of community being created. I seek your advice for everyone in the audience. Should there be standardization as a process, or a Sula festival for a brand's perspective should be more premium than a sunburn because the age groups are different and the affordability is a different factor for both the audiences?
No, in this case, yeah, I say when you're talking about a sunburn or you're giving Sula as a wine fest, I think here with the brand, I think a differentiation in price should be always there.
So isn't that contradicting what you just said?
No,
as
I'm talking
one captive
in terms
audience?
In advertising. In my terms of advertising, when we're talking a fixed inventory, say for example, in case of my ticket sales, we don't have a fixed pricing in ticket sales. It depends on the content or the movie that is coming out, whether it's blockbusters, mid-size, or just a movie. We have change in our pricing in tickets. But where it's coming to advertising, pure advertising, we have a fixed inventory which has a rate card to it. This is what I was saying. We are open to looking at differential in pricing. Like if we are talking blockbuster movies, we have a difference in pricing, but not with advertising.
So, Rajendra, do you think ROI is being asked from all brands that come into your mall?
ROI from all the brands that operate in the malls?
Not the fixed stores, the ones those who get into what I call it pop-up stores for the weekend.
Yes, of course.
And how do you justify ROI? Is it just footfalls? Is it conversions?
It's more of conversions rather than footfalls.
So you're saying sales
India,
is...
In India, I'll tell you, malls do not suffer from footfalls.
I'm sure. What's the last count last week at Phoenix?
You know, it was, I think, that's what I numbered. 2 million was, in fact, at Lower Parel. Pune, we had some 2.4 million. That was the last month.
This is one week number.
1 month.
Wow, man. Guys, isn't this amazing? 2.4 million in a week walking into what he defines as modern mandirs, right? And we go there more frequently. That's a huge number. So, if I am a brand custodian of an FMCG and you say, I'll charge you 3 lakh rupees, and whether I am doing an activity there engaging people or testing my product or, you know, pre-market launch testing I'm doing, how do you justify the ROI questions? You know,
see, from a brand perspective, I'll explain to you what happens is, whether it's a brand launch or whether it's a brand pre-product testing, whichever route you have to follow, whatever product, whatever you want to do there, you are reaching a captive audience which is eventually going to be your TG. That's what makes all the difference. You're not testing or you're not launching it where you don't know who's going to see it, who's going to use it, who's going to test it. This is one arena where you are quite sure that, you know, with whom you want to communicate eventually is the one who are already there right now. From that perspective, the captive audience, I would, you know, what happens is the captive audience, the meaning changes. It actually becomes your TG rather than actually a captive audience. So from that perspective, when you're communicating directly with your right end consumers whom you want to be in your fold, makes all the difference.
So you said 2.4 million people walking in on a week, you know, and obviously these numbers are public. If they were not, now they are.
It's actually for the month, not for the week.
Okay. So for the month, 2.4 million. Obviously the brand custodians would want to jump on, you know, and congregation point like that where you have almost 1.5 million people walking in. And it's a revenue model for you, right? You make money out of pop-up stores. So question I have for you, sir, is in a mall setting where there are a number of brands hosting engagements almost at the same time, right? What are the things that you suggest brands should do to have sustained footfall over their particular, if I may call it the chaos or an experience zone? And what do they do to avoid clutter?
Post 1990, they say content is the king.
That's an easy way out, but...
No, so, you know, what it means is actually, you know, what from our perspective, what it means, when you have so many customers, when you have so many points of attraction, you have to make sure that your point of attraction, where you are, becomes actually one important for you. So engagement, in my view, becomes very, very important. Now, engagement word becomes very English, that, you know, it has multiple connotations when you use that word. But engagement at a mall level, what it means is the customer participation, not only the experience. You know, a tasting can be a very simple, somebody's launching a drink, they make him feel, give him a glass, give him a bottle, sir, like it, not like it, fill up a survey form and get the database and move on. That's one part of the way you launch it. But if you can make that as a genuine experience, the customer is participative in that, that makes all the difference, that makes all the attraction possible, and that makes easy for the brand to actually get result out of that.
Sharat, I'll ask you a question.
Can I just add on? I think you've made a very interesting point, and it's provoked some thoughts that were already latent in my mind, but I think it's interesting to see this come. Is that... to be able to understand what the person is there for and do it and offer a relevant proposition. So if somebody's at the mall and they're there shopping and therefore they're happy or open to trying out new products or services, so trying to give a soft drink or a food item, you know, sauces, noodles, etc. Great time and fantastic place to do it. And ditto, even cars, as I see it, you know, you want aspirationally you're pitching. I think that kind of learning is what we would like to also see happening in the airports. And I just want to give you an example, which is that when people travel on business, most travelers are on business, 80%, but there's a large growing number of leisure travelers, especially come in summer, and it's no longer a luxury to have families traveling by air to their holiday destinations. Now, or indeed college or young adults going off for holidays, etc., and flying. Now, One of the biggest, let us say, need areas today, which young travelers love or want, is Wi-Fi. You know, whenever they're there, they want to keep updating, posting, whatever, FBs, Twitter, etc. And the moment people are out of their home territory, they are incurring what is called roaming charges. Now, if a brand is that wants to target the 22-year-old or the 23-year-old is able to offer to all of them in the airports unlimited Wi-Fi for that 30, 40, 50 minutes, and you know, you go, whether it is buy a Coke and get 20 minutes of can of Coke or Pepsi and get 20 minutes of Wi-Fi free or a Starbucks coffee, whatever it is, you would have a far greater engagement with that person because, sure, they would love to have a coffee or a soft drink or a bite, and they don't want to just be simply sitting around sipping coffee or tea or drinking, having a bite. If they're able to also, you're able to enable them post something free of cost, Wi-Fi, they're downloading mails and whatever it is, that connected, that point, that moment of truth, saying, gosh, here is this brand which, you know, Coke or Pepsi or Starbucks, I was on holiday, I was out of home range, I was anyway blown a lot of money on my holiday, I didn't want to spend another 500 rupees uploading stuff on FB. They gave me free Wi-Fi and I appreciate that tremendously. That connect is far more valuable, and that ROI is what we need to calculate, rather than, it's a billboard, costs 30 lakhs a month, 20 million have walked in, and then point in time. So that is critical. So in the malls, soft drink or a product sampling, fantastic. They're there with that retail one. I don't think at the malls, for example, if you were to pitch something which is not in sync with their mood at that point in time, it would not have that kind of offtake.
That's so do I take a point out of both of your statements, that you're saying, instead of making it just a point of attraction in that audience, in that captive space, can we make it a point of interaction more than just having static visibility or static stall displays or sampling? Is that what you both are saying?
Yes.
Okay, excellent. I have a question for you, Clyde, which says, while in a theater, the audience's share of mind is already captured on the content, right? They're there to watch. They are captive for those 2.5, 3, or if it's a Western-influenced movie or an English movie, it's 1.5 or 2. You know, as brands, don't you think it's intriguing to get into his personal pre-captured space? You know, how do you get this question quite often that I'm here as a consumer, this is a question as a consumer, that I'm here to watch this movie for 3 hours and you are, showing in messages and throwing in communication by this life insurance and by this new biscuit which has been launched, Isn't that intriguing? Do you think it's fair to invade in that privacy?
See, basically when they're coming down there to a multiplex, they're coming with a frame of mind to watch a movie. They're more in a leisure kind of a mind. So when they're there, I think I've never got a question that are we intruding into someone's privacy or getting into their time over there? Because see, at the most, they've got 15 minutes on a foyer. In 15 minutes, what would you do? You would actually look around, You have time. You have time to spare. You have time to meet people. You want to network if you catch somebody around out there. And we utilize the time, basically, when we are actually getting ads out there is when it is a free time before the movie starts or during the interval is when we're actually utilizing their time out there when they come to a multiplex. So I don't see that we're actually getting into their personal space any.
So can we just do a quick dipstick here? How many of you go to movies?
Everyone.
Excellent. So Bollywood sells, right?
Yeah.
And how many of you think what Clyde is saying is justified from a consumer perspective, not from the business that we are all in the marketing space and we obviously need our monthly salaries and our bills to be paid? Just from a consumer stage, how many of you think that we should encourage brands being present, as he rightly said, pre and post, assuming that they don't just barge in while the movie is on? How many of you think it is right to have brands pre and post? Well, that's encouraging. Sir, your business is still going steady. So, excellent. Chad, you wanted to add something on this, did you?
No, I think the biggest challenge as I see it when we are looking at airports and wearing that hat, so to speak, is that the way in which we can provoke the brand custodians, and I see, when I say brand custodians, it's not just the brand manager, the client. I see agencies performing that vital role of making the client take that leap into moving away from standard metrics or standard KPI, saying CPT, CPM, etc., into something that is more meaningful, which is saying that there is a business objective that the client has, and therefore how we can help him do that, help him or her achieve that. And that is what I'd like to be able to focus
on. So very, very well said. I have a controversial question to ask you, Sharad.
Oh, okay.
Right?
Gosh.
You know, given the higher costs, that obviously it's not, you know, you also procure your rights of airports at a fairly substantial cost, you know. The higher cost to you and then to the brand, which is a huge dent in the pocket. You know, airport as a medium, people want to get in there. But I think most of the people, and I can tell you from my experience of handling 300 plus brands at any given point of time in a year, you know, people don't want to go to airports because it's bloody damn expensive to get into your home, right?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So how do you make it more available to brands that it can be a justified investment?
Okay, if clients or brand custodians and indeed influencers such as you clearly feel that it's expensive, then I think as an asset marketer, I have failed in my making a compelling and persuasive enough case for it.
So if I just butt in, yeah. If I go to a mall, it's far more economical to do a weekend activity, and you guys don't necessarily do only weekend because there's security permission, or that's an easy thing to get, is it?
No, I think the challenges of logistics remain. So there is no way in which in the current environment you can one fine morning saying, hey, there's a new offer that's come up and I want to react in 24 or 48 hours. So there is that challenge that remains. And therefore, I don't think you can do a weekend promotion overnight. Can you do a weekend promotion 10 days or 15 days in advance? Yes.
That so you're saying plan in advance and do it right.
Some degree of planning is required. And I can share with you again, the old school to go pre-90 days is that there was a time when if your campaign had to break, you had to send the beta tapes to Star in Hong Kong 10 days before, including. So essentially a campaign.
Pre-90s, right?
Pre-90s. So the whole concept that, oh gosh, my campaign has to break on February 20th meant that as of today, the betas had to be shipped out today so that it can break on February 20th. Today, we are in a situation where somebody says, listen, I want the campaign to break day after tomorrow. I'll upload it tomorrow morning. And we are up and running. So that amount of planning that used to exist there today does not exist because technology or there has been a disruption in that space. Similarly, there will be a disruption here in some fashion or the other, and we look forward to being able to create that disruption to make the entire asset far more approachable and usable than it was, let's say.
So, Rajinder, you have an opportunity here. He's saying it is difficult for us to convert, and most of the brand custodians sitting here would agree that their agencies or their partners get hardly 4 days' time to plan, execute and be rolling, because we are all becoming a quarterly measurable business, right? What is the sale of the quarter? So there is a huge business opportunity that you can snatch away from him, and I'm putting you against each other and saying, would you want to do that, or would you want to look at more planned way and bring in technology more at malls? Because I don't see technology playing a role from a property owner point of view. You just encourage and lease out square feet space. But there is no contribution from malls into generating captive audience as an organized market, right? It's anybody who comes in 2 days before and says, okay, I have this space available. No category conflict. Even if the store is Nokia and you're selling Samsung outside, doesn't matter, as long as the moolah is coming. Is that right?
In a way, that's true, because it's a business model also. So from my perspective as mall owner, maybe that's true. But from the brand perspective, that's perhaps not true. That's why he's spending that money. What happens is, even if there are, see, it's a competitive world. the market size, you know, just to take that example of the same handset gadget, it's a good 175,000 crore is the market size of gadgets in India. So, you know, in a mall, you will see 20 stores. You will see a large size Chroma also, and you will see a large size digital also. And you will see a large size Jumbo also. And you will see after that a brand store also. You will see a BlackBerry also, Nokia also, Samsung also, HTC also, Lenovo also. The point is, I don't think competition makes all the difference. Competition brings the best out of you. It depends what is your differentiator, what is your proposition to the customer. So even if there are multiple brands at the same time, you know, just to give you a small example, we hosted at something called a Tech Fest, where we had all these multiple brands with the latest gadgets actually trying to catch up customers' time. And everybody had a win-win situation. You know, even Samsung was happy, even Nokia was happy, even Micromax was happy, and even a Lenovo was happy. So what happens is, see, I'll tell you a major difference between what here and here happens. They come with a fixed mindset. They have a restricted time there. Whereas in malls, the dwell time can stretch from 15 minutes to 5 hours also, 6 hours also. And you'll find a few mall rats who will spend their whole day also. So, you know, at mall, he's genuinely at leisure. He doesn't have any pre-thoughts in his mind that he has to do this, he has to do that. So the engagement becomes very easy there. He's actually a very easy catch for a good marketeer there.
I think that's a very valid point. Gentleman is saying malls, you have more time to plan in, as a consumer journey. But if you go into a movie, you have 3 hours. You have to plan it right. You have to execute it right. Your communication has to be right. And, you know, I see a lot of technology playing an important role at airports these days. Is this the investment of the brands who get in, or... And I'm purely talking from captive audience point of view. Or is it an effort from Times that goes in and trying to import a lot of technology-led solutions?
I think very often when we are trying to bring in a new thinking, we are very happy to invest a bit into the technology to help a brand realize this leap that they're taking that is there. So there's some amount of investment, and we are open to therefore making these kind of investments to help somebody experience something new. So to that extent, we try and mitigate the risk to the extent possible. That's it.
So on the paucity of time, I'll make Q&A open to the floor. We'll restrict ourselves to 3 questions, please. You have 3 panelists. You can take your own, wear your boxing gloves, share your experience, ask them the questions if you would want to. Just raise your hand and mic will reach to you. Any questions on the floor? Do you all agree to all the 3 statements? I'll just sum it up. You know, mostly we are saying instead of point of attraction, make it a point of interaction, right? Free is the most sold word as long as it is adding value to the brand proposition. The third point we understood was that competition really brings the best out of you because there is clutter, there is a lot of noise in the captive audience spaces on malls and, you know, multiplexes especially. So these are the primary big points which came out of this discussion. Any questions you would want to ask any of the 3 panelists? Their time's really precious. You have them on the floor. The gentleman in the white there.
I just heard about the Tech Fest thing that you spoke about, which was organized. And now when you organize a festival like a Tech Fest, the thing is that the same categories share the same space inside the mall. So when this happens, do you think this is, for example, for the consumer, obviously it is beneficial because he's able to roam around and then, you know, get access to different products and different services, and he gets a lot of knowledge in that way. But in terms of the brand perspective, do you think that when a fest like this happens, can brands share the same space in the same fest, under the same umbrella, in the same categories? Do you think that is appropriate for the brand?
From the same category, why not? If it's, you know, it's a different kind of categories, maybe, you know, when you have a mobile and somebody is selling, maybe showing you a top there, maybe that's not the right categories. But from a customer perspective, it's always the category, you know, the same category is always important. That's where, you know, the basic point, what is retail? Retail is the power of choice to a customer. So that's what you offer them there. So that power of choice to a consumer, unless that is available, you don't give him an experience. So that's very important from that perspective.
Sir, if I can just add to that, I think, you know, the traditional human behavior, if you see in offline, you always have, let's say, auto spare parts. There'll all be one lane with all auto spare parts. There'll be one lane which has all the electronics, and there'll be one lane which has all the masalas, etc. So that has been a part and parcel of human behavior from time immemorial. I think malls are essentially a reflection of the evolution and offering a better, you know, experience rather than saying that we are going to be exclusive. If I can just, you know, add to that.
Yes, sir.
Hi, my name is Deepak Saluja. I represent one of the financial institute on the marketing side. The question is to, you know, all the three panelists. While I understand the reference of the typical OOH media that you're talking in context of cinema, airport, or malls, I think one of the situations that we grapple with, you know, when we're looking at planning, is the contextualizing the experience from a brand perspective. How do you actually relate it to the brand and therefore fit in the consumer mix is missing most of the time when we get these, you know, detailing or detailed proposals coming from respective mediums. So it typically lands out to be a call coming on an OH and stating that we have an airport site available, would you be interested? Or, you know, we have a cinema advertising available, would you be interested? There is nothing beyond that that can be perceived as value, which helps us to make a decision on, you know, the opportunity loss or the opportunity which is residing there. And then it gets mixed up into the overall parlance of what's the moolah we have and where do we put in our dollars. So I think that's another space which I think as asset owners, you probably need to think through from a brand experience. You know, knowing the consumer is fine, but from a brand, how do you fit in the solutions that you're talking about?
A very, very important, very valid question. I think sort of that reinforces the need of agencies to exist, I guess. And but as brand owners or as real estate owners, are there efforts going on from all three of you to understand the brand perspective and not just sell inventory?
Shall I ask? You know, I will give you exactly reverse experience we normally face. You know, what you're saying is very, very important because it's in brand's interest to have something good at the mall or at the cinema or at the airport. My personal experience is the brands come up with the product, the setups, the shops, the people who actually you are there for engaging. They are of so substandard quality that it creates a negative impact from a customer's perspective. That makes a lot of sense because that's what makes all the difference about. When you see a setup, you know, it has to be of a, you know, when, let's take an example, you go to a first class business lounge of an airport and Moet and Chandon has to do some display there. You know, they have to entice some customers. Look at what they would do. And then come next phase, the same first class, if supposing, you know, Indian IMFL has to do there. Look at what setup they would put. That makes all the difference. That's where the real engagement from you comes as agencies, as marketeers, as brand ambassadors, that, you know, you must differentiate what you have to produce at what location. That becomes very, very important. And that's where I think we all have to put those efforts, that up the ant, this is what has to be offered. This is that, you know, we have to come out of that ROI and money and think of experience, what is good and what is not good. That makes all the difference.
So I think as Rajender is saying, experiment with good quality, at least, you know, sort of spend some time on quality as well. Is that what you're saying?
Primarily onto the, you know, the people who interact from these asset owner classes which come across to us, they typically go on to that mundane space selling, which is what kind of, you know, doesn't work in the favor for the brand, because we are also interested in understanding what are the learnings that are there on your medium, what could be looked at as something which would differentiate the experience that we are talking about, and what are the permutation combinations that are possible, which at times, most of the times rather, is lacking. So you may get 10 calls from OOH media and it's the same thing about space selling. So I think that's where probably you need to reinvent the model of selling and look at it from a brand or the category and then propose what you have in mind.
putting words in my mouth, but you know, there will be a lot of agencies, some of them would be present here, when even after paying the money, their setups would not have been allowed in few of our malls because it was not up to the standard.
So standardization is what Rajender is saying, but we agree to what you're saying.
You know, that's what I'm saying. That is more than the venue, it is the brand and the marketeer and the agencies who have to take interest in that.
So panel says we are here to make money and that's our job. But there are intermediaries, influencers and agencies. It is their job to make a brand experience real. We will only accept, is what I'm interpreting, that if you maintain a certain quality, because Phoenix as a brand or airport or mall or multiplexes as a brand have built their own brand equity as well, they would want to at least maintain and sustain it. Right? Any more questions from the audience? Thank you very much for being very calm, patient. Really appreciate this. It's a house full. A round of applause for all of you. Thank you, panelists. Thank you.